Have you ever wondered how an aircraft carrier landing actually works? Why is it so hard? And what goes on before and after the jet smashes into the deck? As the aircraft carrier USS Gerald R Ford exits Arctic waters and heads south, we wrap up our story of the aircraft carrier's adventure in the north by exploring how the jets are orchestrated down, safe and sound, ready to fight again. Welcome back to In Bello. The challenges of landing on an aircraft carrier are many and require a special set of skills very few are selected for. Imagine flying a high-performance fighter jet at incredible speeds and then attempting to land it on a moving runway that's only a fraction of the size of a regular airfield. It requires tremendous skill, precision, and nerves of steel. The carrier landing is often referred to as the controlled crash for a reason. The deck is pitching, rolling, and heaving with the movements of the ship, while the pilot must focus on aligning their aircraft with the deck's arresting wires. It's an intense and unforgiving process. During the recovery phase of a mission, the aircraft carrier becomes a carefully choreographed ballet of jets and support personnel. Carrier Air Wing 8, based on the Gerald Ford, is a prime example of this seamless coordination. As the fighter jets return to the carrier, the flight deck crew springs into action. Deck handlers wearing different colored jerseys work together to guide the aircraft to their designated spots with precision and efficiency. The job of the deck crew is to ensure the safe recovery of each aircraft as they communicate using standardized hand signals and follow a well-rehearsed choreography. Every movement is timed and coordinated to maintain the highest level of safety and efficiency. Once an aircraft is lined up with the deck behind the ship, the pilot is guided down towards the boat by radio calls from fellow squadron mates, the landing signal officers, and by the aid of a series of lights on a lens, known as the Meatball. As the pilot approaches the end, he must make a split-second decision to either execute a touch-and-go if he misses the wires, or a trap landing. A touch-and-go landing involves touching down on the deck briefly and then applying full power to take off again. This is typically done when the pilot needs to perform additional maneuvers or if the landing conditions are not favorable, or if he simply misses the wires stretched across the deck. This is known as a bolter and usually comes with a chewing out from the fellow squadron aviators. On the other hand, a trap landing is the conventional method. The pilot aims to catch one of the arresting wires on the deck with a tail hook, which rapidly decelerates the aircraft. Regardless, the pilot presses his throttles fully forward to max power the instant he hits the deck, to be able to take off again if the tail hook doesn't catch. It's a make-or-break moment that demands utmost precision. The tail hook is a small but critical component of the aircraft. It's designed to catch the arresting wires, bringing the jet to a stop in just a few seconds. The pilot must time their approach and have the right angle of attack for the hook to catch a wire while hitting the deck with all three wheels in a safe manner. Once an aircraft successfully traps, it taxis clear of the landing area, making room for the next aircraft to land. The cycle continues as the pilots of Carrier Air Wing 8 complete their missions and return home. But a lot is happening in the air above the boat as well. As the landing cycle begins, the airborne squadrons start to approach the carrier and neatly enter a stack above the boat, making circles in formation at different altitudes, always mindful of how much fuel they have left. In some cases, someone leaves the stack to have a drink from a tanker which is airborne nearby. Other times, they decide they are unable to land on the boat that day and turn their nose toward the mainland to find a dry airfield to land on. The stack is coordinated from the marshal inside the boat, who always makes sure to get every bird down as efficiently as possible. When the time is right, a flight of aircraft is given the signal to leave the stack and start a long turn to enter the ship from behind, in what we see in videos as an awesome formation break. The formation overhead break procedure is an essential part of the recovery phase. After leaving the stack, the aircraft approach the carrier in an echelon formation from behind at 800 feet and 350 knots exactly. As the lead passes over the deck, he checks the deck before kissing his flight off. With an instant jerk, he rips the jet off from the formation as he bleeds off speed to be able to lower his landing gear. As he rolls out abreast and opposite heading to the aircraft carrier, the jet is set up for landing, and the pilot goes through his checklist. As he sees the stern of the ship on his left, he once again starts a full left turn, a turn that ends almost as he touches down on the ship. The rest of the flight has broken off behind him on an exact interval of 17 seconds. This allows the aircraft to establish a suitable spacing between each other and provides a clear visual reference of the carrier and its deck. The formation break is crucial for maintaining safety during the landing phase. It allows each pilot to independently adjust their approach and landing configuration based on the prevailing conditions. This flexibility ensures that each aircraft can adapt to the dynamic environment of the carrier deck and make the necessary adjustments to achieve a safe and successful landing. The formation break also enhances the visibility of each aircraft to the landing signal officer, LSO, and the carrier's flight deck crew. It can be challenging for the LSO to assess their individual positions and make landing adjustments, so there is usually more than one, wearing signal white coveralls on the back of the deck. Each one has a panic button, which, if pressed, tells the pilot to immediately cancel the approach and go around for another approach. Landing on an aircraft carrier is an incredible test of a pilot's skill and nerve. It requires precise control inputs, split-second decision-making, and unwavering focus. The pilot must maintain situational awareness, monitor the deck's movements, and make constant adjustments to ensure a safe and successful landing. This nerve-wracking procedure applies as long as the weather is fair and there is daylight. When night comes, or the weather worsens, everything changes, and the almost impossible feat of hitting the deck becomes even more frighteningly difficult. But that is for another video. As we conclude the journey of the aircraft carrier Gerald R. Ford and the challenges of landing on an aircraft carrier, we gain a newfound appreciation for the skill, coordination, and bravery of the pilots and the flight deck crew. The Gerald R. Ford and Carrier Air Wing 8 exemplify the highest standards of naval aviation. Join us again as we explore more fascinating aspects of the aviation world. Until then, fly safe and keep reaching for the skies.